speak.
Yeah, so let's get things going. So welcome, one and all, to another Wargame War Room with me, Rangaroo. The discussion show where we talk about balance with all the different mechanics of Wargame Red Dragon. And today, I am joined by...
El Baba, I play for PLF.
Mystic, Lone Wolf, play with all the good clans.
Hi, I'm Tryon, play with Epic.
I'm Random, I'm a member of the What the Fox clan.
I'm Rangaroo, the host.
I'm the Shriveless One, and I play for PLF.
And today, our discussion topic will be all about maps, map design, map balance, good maps, bad maps, everything about maps. This Wargame has a lot of maps, 34, 35 maps, I believe. So quite an awful lot. So to get things started, just some simple question. What are some good maps and good maps for balance, or good balanced maps that are fun to play on, in your opinion?
Bloody Ridge comes to mind first.
Definitely Bloody Ridge, Paddy Field, Hop in Glory.
Bungalow is quite decent.
And what makes these maps, like, why do you guys like these maps?
Because it's balanced for the jungle.
For Bloody Ridge?
Bloody Ridge, the approach to Bloody Ridge is pretty balanced. It's not that wide a map. Zones are pretty evenly distributed. There are some problems on Bloody Ridge, though. Some bugs that need to be ironed out. For one thing, this zone here, one second, let me just get to it.
Also, I just want to just describe to the audience, we're using this thing called Triddler, which allows us to publicly edit images. We got a nice image loaded for every single map, so we can do your ESPN, sports, play, highlights, and all our different sectors. And I have their name, or their colours corresponding on the left.
That area on that map is bugged. Units get stuck under there when you call them out. It can really, really mess up
on that little
the entire
island?
Side. Pardon me?
On that little island?
Yeah. That's a spawn zone that needs to be fixed. It's been mentioned before, but they have not done anything about it yet.
But there is go ahead, Mystic.
Well, it allows for different sorts of play. You know, town fighting, open field, tank fights. A lot of maneuver warfare. It's not restricted to just one type of fighting.
And I think it's also nice because it's very laned. Like, you got three distinct lanes to go through. You got lane number one, lane number two, and lane number three for three players to equally distribute all their forces down. So it's kind of easy to say one guy go this side, one guy go the other side, and one guy go the other side.
Yeah, it's a pretty straightforward map.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and most importantly, it's not split in half by a river.
Mm-hmm. And I like how it has room for flanking, and as you said before, it allows all these different types of play styles to come into play, like infantry, tank fight in the middle, and the bottom side is just a very nasty choke point.
Yeah, and there's pretty nice flanking opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
Well, on the upper edges.
Problem. Yeah, I mean, but on the sides, you can send a couple units, but I don't think you can send lots of units.
No.
Like, you can send a recon, but you can't really send a heavy and some mediums or something.
Mm-hmm.
No, definitely not. But sometimes
that's
it's enough to get a recon.
Well, I just made a huge
If you press
thing,
undo,
right.
It should get rid of it, I believe. Undo at the bottom, top right.
Could just do clear markup.
I don't see it. Whatever.
There you go.
Under there is a city, and whoever gets that city will be attacking on the top for the rest of the game. So I don't really like that.
On Bloody Ridge.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you do have a good point there, because you have this little ridge here. And you have these ridges here. And if you control these ridges, you can easily dominate middle. or other way around, as it allows you to actually go into all the other sectors very easily by having that middle sector. It's a very vital point, that middle sector, because it just opens up so many roads to all the other different places.
But as Random said, that's where the game is decided.
Mm-hmm.
It's that city. Because if you've got that city, guys, you might want to make your markers thinner. You could select the option at the top. Okay, this city, if you've got this city right here, right, it's very easy to get across and take out anything in here, literally. Mm-hmm. You can just walk in there with no problems, and as you said before, you could then just flank downwards here, you could flank this way here, and, you know, options just open up everywhere. So, Triumph actually had a proposal the other day we were discussing. Triumph, didn't you mention to make one of the zones smaller? Or something?
You're correct. Let's say you have the city, you're playing from the left side. So, left side has the city. When you're trying to attack into that area, CV around that circle or in this line area can be really difficult to spot. I think that the zone there should be made a bit smaller, so that way it's easier to harass. Also, I find that this starting zone, this area right here, gives a small advantage when moving into the middle. And that's just a pure zone design there. When trying to attack out from the left, I've noticed that players have issues going from this poorly designed arrow right there. Just minor zone changes would help things. I'm not sure what can be done to help the left go on the attack with the city.
Well, if you're on the left, you have just the same chance to get the city in the beginning, and once you have it, you can decap this very easily. And after that, you can push him out.
The problem is that... instead of saying left and right, since we've got the thing up right now, the right side has got two roads leading up to that area, which is, in my opinion, a pretty big advantage. Because locking off two roads with napalm or any sort of attack is really hard. It's not easy to do. Whereas the left side, right, it's only got a solo road right there, one napalm, or whatever sort of strike that you want to do can effectively deny the enemy from getting the city. And that, I think, is a bit of a problem, balance-wise.
But you have still only one road right here, so you just got to throw your napalm right there.
Well, you do have one road, but one road you bring armor from, one road you bring your infantry from. You wouldn't bring your armor from that center road.
And having fought on that side a lot, that second road that goes... at the top, that's a
somewhere
huge advantage
here.
For that side. Yeah, that's a huge advantage. I mean, you can get your armor into position way quicker. You can much easier get around onto the flank of the city, cut off the reinforcements.
Yeah, there's a perfect hedgerow for you here as well. Dane.
I don't know, I prefer it if the city were, like, up here or something. I'd much prefer it because, like this, once you have the city, you won't lose it, so there is no opportunity to counterattack from the side who loses the city.
Mm-hmm. So it's usually, when I usually play at a match, it's always just an infantry rush of SAS, territorials, and fusiliers just rush in, and napalm infantry trying to get into that city and try to control it, because as you said, it's like it's the heart of the map.
Yeah, sort of, but what you have to remember is that if you go really too infantry heavy, mm-hmm. Okay, you have a ton of infantry in the city, but I've played matches where we just... put some infantry into the city and then just move up with armor from both sides. The guy invests all his points into infantry, then let him sit there. It's mm-hmm. You don't have to go through the city to get to the other side.
So I many do people... think, though... Sorry, go ahead, Bubba.
Yeah, go ahead, Mr. K.
I do think, though, that Random makes a good point that it would be nicer if the city was somewhere up here. I would prefer it myself if the city was not such a important sector, and probably extend the road that you've got already here, you know, somewhere down here like this. So you have two roads leading in, basically.
They'd sort of make it like a four-lane map in a way, it seems, because you have, like, that road that you proposed, like, up here, and then this road up here, so one player over here and the second player over here, third, and then fourth.
So I think, to an extent, in a 4v4, it already is kind of a four-lane map. Mm-hmm. You have someone that's just dedicated armor and support for the city, and another person's just strictly city fighting.
Mm-hmm. What about the... Go ahead.
There's one thing for starting. Maybe if the far-left zone was extended over to about there in some way, you'd be able to take a road down and do some sort of transfer and come up from that way. So that way you have what's already on the map taken as a natural two-prong for each left and right side.
That's true.
And that would take a lot less in the changes department. I don't think that city blocks have ever been added to a map post-release. It's only been a little bit of forest when everyone really, really needed it. And besides that, it's been sector changes. Sector changes seem like they are the easiest thing for them to implement.
I don't think they can do anything but sector changes at this point.
No, can't they edit the map? Because maps, because I remember in AOB, one of the Forge map, they fixed the bridge on the app. So can't they edit the maps in minor ways?
They can definitely move the point sectors around. Even on this map, the sectors have been moved.
But they can't, like, reshape the map. They can't, like, add a new town somewhere.
No, not that, but the sectors can be moved themselves.
So that's the only thing that can be changed is the sectors.
Yeah, as far as I know, yeah.
There's also, speaking of this map, do you guys think it's possible to attack down in that four lane down there? Do you think that's possible to do, or is it just more of a defensive thing in
it
both of these towns?
It depends on the open.
Explain.
If someone tries to double the middle with another player, then they'll probably only have 100, 200 points and stuff in their bottom city. You can probe that with, like, a BTR, and then you can pour infantry into there and do an attack. Get recce on a command vehicle.
I have done that attack multiple times, and it can work, but normally, no matter what, it turns into a very large grind fight.
Yeah.
And unless you're ready for something like that, even if they only have like 100 points, it can last into a 15-minute battle just for the first two blocks alone.
Because that, like, at bottom sectors, right, yeah, like, fighting that place a lot with my Aussie deck, it always goes down in napalm, just a sea and sea of napalm. Because it's so narrow, you can just get two napalm bombers and get all the infantry.
Just resupply route so long and... it's hard to sustain a fight in that city.
Mm-hmm.
Or unless you really get it with a big shock in the beginning, it's really hard to keep on grinding it.
And normally the nice fallback zone is this ridge here. Because even if you can't get the city, if you can get that ridge and hold on to it, you can really easily change the fight in the middle, which is a couple of ATGMs.
And lastly, how do you guys approach the middle of the map, the middle sectors? Like, what is your tactic for that?
Depends if it's a 3v3 engagement or a 4v4.
What do you do on a 3v3, let's just say?
On a 3v3, since, you know, fighting in this sector, and this sector is really a grind fest, as everyone has mentioned, it's not wise really to put sink all your points into those two sectors for those players who are dedicated to those flanks. So what you would do would be put probably, you know, have a 60-40 ratio. 60% of your resources at the start go to that initial sector, and then 40% you can probably dedicate to this area completely. And then you have one guy dedicated to the middle completely, and you have another guy dedicated to the top. So it's, it all comes down to the bottom area.
Mm-hmm. Right?
You don't want to dedicate too many resources there because it's just wasted. You're not doing anything. And after that, you just try to get recon up everywhere. And that's a tank fight area. That entire area is a tank fighting area.
I like that middle sector a lot because you have those two headlines right here, and they're perfect for tank fights as it gives you cover from ATGMs, but you can usually pop through, get a few shots off, and then back up. It's really fun for doing a tank ATGM fight down here.
It's also really tough if you're playing NATO and the other guy brings double smirches and Buratinos. It's because the area of cover is so small where you can keep your CV, it can be. The 4v4, especially if you have two guys, Chinese MLRS napalming it or smirching or Buratinoing, it's really nasty.
Mm-hmm. So, overall, Bloody Ridge, good map, good competitive map in its current state.
I'd say so.
Definitely.
I don't like it very much, but I guess it's just personal preference.
So, any other good maps that you guys like? And we can talk about it. Tactics, all that rubbish.
Jungle Law is quite nice.
What map, sorry?
Jungle Law.
Okay, let's scroll down to that. I believe that's a 3v3. Hold on. Yeah, Jungle Law. Oh yeah, this map is a nice one. And what do you guys like think of this map? Like, how do you play it?
I find that 3v3. For 3v3, it will turn into a 2-player, 1-player split. The lower area will be occupied by 1 player from each team. 2 players will be playing over the mid or the top. Not sure if it's the most competitive map. Haven't really had too many competitive games. Middle is an infantry meat grinder. Enjoy your napalm.
Yeah, I find in the competitive games I've played on it, the middle normally actually ends up being something that just stays contested for most of the game due to the amount of napalm and everything else that's going on. It's very hard to hide units. It's very obvious where all your units will be.
Where is the middle for you?
The middle... Talking about middle zone, what would be this one I'm outlining?
Oh, yeah. Well,
I mean, that's not really dead middle of the map, but the middle zone.
Yeah, the string state, the string zone.
I really like it for 2v2. I think it has a nice size for it. And I like the balancing because left side, it has an advantage in the middle and the top sector, like... this one and this one, but it pretty much can't get to the one below. So the one below is always for the right team, but the right team is at a disadvantage for the fight for those two sectors.
I really like this map just because of all the hills and the aesthetic of it, because you have all these hills and ridge lines that make it look like a very odd and not like straight map, but it's very easily laned. You got run lane up here, run lane down here, and run lane down here, and you sort of have a lane down here. I really like this little ridge line that I just outlined right here, just due to the fact it's just... You could do a nice little surprise flank down here, and if you control it, you can move down into here, move down into here, move down into here. For the other team, you can move down into here and into here quite easily. So I think that little ridge line that I just... That little, like... Yeah, little ridge. That's usually a very good strategic point to hold at. Not many people, when I play at map, go for at the start. Easy to sort of ignore it.
Yeah, it's nice for sneak attacks or like a couple of units, but it's a little bit of a problem that it's so narrow. I think it can get locked down if you are ready for an attack there or have some.
Yeah, I normally find last in those matches it becomes like a defensive line there and about there. I don't really find anyone really pushes that much further, unless there's a huge disadvantage to one side.
Last time I made a halo rush through the middle, in the end of the game, get some points, but I haven't really used it other than that.
And then you got the top part here, which I find to be a pretty ATGM-y area. It's a place always stay contested in a lot of maps that I play, because if you want to move forward, open ground, a lot of open ground, and you got ATGMs coming from here and here, and even from that forest where you can get some nice side shots, usually turns into a giant meat grinder inside that top sector. And then you got like the middle sector, which, as you said, usually stay contested. And it's a pretty. I like the map an awful lot. It just gives you a lot of pathways for you to move in and out through an entire map. And well, it's pretty well balanced. I think it's pretty evenly split. You know, same rust time for both sides. Wouldn't you agree?
I'd say it's quite balanced. The only issue I really have with this map is if you get pushed out of one sector, it's very, very, very hard to get back into that contested zone.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of areas, especially the middle with those forested hills. You can completely lock down someone from ever getting back in there if you take it.
I don't know. I mean, pushed out of those or pushed someone out? Are you in 3v3 or also in 2v2?
I've played a lot of 3v3s on this and 4v4s. I don't have much experience with it on 2v2s.
I only have played 2v2 on this.
I mean, I know like 3v3s, if someone gets that middle and they can push you back to this river, then this zone over here is already determined and they're not really getting back across that river with just like 4 ATGMs there.
Yeah. You don't get across the river once their unit's on the other.
Good map. We can all agree.
It's okay.
Yeah, it's okay.
Playable.
Any other good maps you guys want to go over?
Paddy Fields.
Let's go to Paddy Fields. Yeah, it is. Right, yeah, 3v3 map. So, any opening comments about it?
Quite balanced, I like it.
Yeah, very balanced. Well, quite balanced. Very straightforward. That's what's nice about it. Evenly distributed. There should be more maps like this.
Definitely.
Zones are pretty equal. No glaring advantages or disadvantages to each side.
At least there's asymmetrical balance to each side.
Yeah.
So the middle of that is.
Yeah, I mean, here you have a little problem, I think, because here you have a city, which means you can slow down the enemy a lot if you have infantry in there. The other side you don't have it, but I'm not really sure which side is better. I haven't really thought about it too much.
I'd have to agree with Randomly about that city. Every time I play this map, I find the outside usually wins the most, just due to the fact that city is such a nice advantage, because you got the city here, and then you got the forest. Well, the other side only got this forest, where they can only hide their units. So, that city on left side, they rush all the way down here, got some ATGMs, plop, plop, plop. They can stop any, you know, helicopter rushes, any tank rushes going across the open field. So it's very easy to defend. While the other side, you don't really got all that much. I believe that you got this little ridge line here, little hedge line. That's not really too much cover, and you do got this little town, which is nice. It's rich. I know, I always find left side have a bit of an advantage just because of that shitty. If they'd maybe move it into the middle right bang here, like very like fill in the circle, I think it'd be a lot more better, the map.
I find left side has a little bit of an advantage there. There is the asymmetrical balance of having that town, there's this L-shaped forest here and this L-shaped forest here. The issue is, though, I found that there's normally a dead spot about there where ATGM troops can't hit, and if used properly, you can easily push in.
What about the bottom sector of the map? That's very awkward, because you got all these like small little town sectors all connecting for each other and very awkwardly placed forests, so you can't really do any ATGM stuff.
I've actually found ATGMs to be quite useful on the bottom side.
Where do you usually place them on them?
I find there's all these little hedges that are around, like that you have if you're attacking from the left side, and a couple of ATGMs there. You can see clearly up to the ridge that brings the troops up, and you can pick off a couple of carriers, tanks that are moving up, that type of stuff.
But do you think it's viable to move into these two sectors, like attack them from the other sector? Like, is it
definitely?
Like, yeah, like, definitely.
How would you do it?
Do it every game.
How would you do it? Because I have no idea how you do it.
Infantry.
Just special forces. Infantry. Shock and special forces through the forests.
Like, would you...
With tanks and so on. So backing it up.
Rifle troops.
There'd be like a Russ early on that you guys would do, or just sort of something you do mid-game?
I find early game pretty much dedicates who's going to be the attacker, who's going to be the defender. Normally, whoever the defender is won't get fully pushed out of the sector, but it will get neutralized at some point.
Hmm. Oh, but what I like about it is that in this area there is, that's a little large, there's one building right in the, there's few building right there, and so that's very nice, because as soon as there are a certain amount of building, it's really bad for gameplay, in my opinion.
Yeah, so, and what I like about this map is that the rivers are not intertwining with the battle, they're not splitting the map in half.
They kind of split up the front lines. Like, you got, like, this sector would be, like, the front line to right team, and then this place would be the front line for left team. Once you go across that bridge, you're open for attack and array. And then...
Yeah. Go ahead.
One cool thing. If you know that someone's going to napalm open along that area, you can actually get forces down here and move, like, your IFVs and stuff like that there.
Mm-hmm. So you can sort of take advantage of the river. Then also, my favorite sector has to be the top sector, the no man's land of the game. Because it's completely void of all cover except for one ridge line here, and a little, one hedge line, and a little spot,
Yeah, that's a praying field for ATGM planes.
Alright.
I'm not 100% thrilled with that area. Like, one little dot of cover, additional dot, like right around there would be nice for left side.
I always find that sector to be, I always do really cheesy strategies on that sector, like buy 5 Concours infantry off the bat, unload them all, and just get a nice long line down the bloody little hedge line, they can't get shot at by ATGMs, but I can shoot all their tanks and vehicles that try to come forward. And then, as you said, get up the ATGM planes at the Peace Rhines and SU-25Ts and just wreck havoc on anything that dare comes up.
Yeah, and I like this map also because it's not it's not determined only in one sector how the battle goes. Like, for instance, in Bloody Ridge, it's almost always about the town, but here you can just hold the center, or you can double team the upper side. Get the upper side, then there's really no getting back over the bridge. Once you get pushed back over the bridge, then it's game over almost for that sector.
Yeah, you do have a good point, because all these sides are very, like, you can attack all of them pretty equally, right? Isn't it just, like, a moss pit in the middle, or moss pit at the top? It's nicely, evenly distributed.
Yeah, it's...
By the way, just a side note, Peace Rhine and SU-25T are not cost-effective. They're pieces of crap.
Really? I see a lot of people using the Peace Rhine, just a side note. I find that to be a very good plane because it has, you know, really fast ATGM or really fast reload time, so you can bring it up, kill a TATRM, bring it up, kill a TATRM, so on and so forth.
The Peace Run is good, but it gets really overshadowed by the Kahu, which is one, cheaper, and two, a lot stronger because it's more survivable and it has 4 more AP on its 2 missiles.
Huh. Okay. More curious, it makes a huge difference until we see medium tank, heavy metagame.
And the only way you'll use a Peace Rhine is if you're going to side shot TADUMs. You ain't going to kill it with it frontally.
Not even a both missiles hit?
Nope.
Oh.
Because, think about it, 26 minus 26 divided by 3 plus 1, 4. That's 8 damage. It would still have 2 bars of health left.
Okay, I see.
I find the only effective way using SU-25T is not to kill, but to deny sectors for about 2 minutes at a time from an armored attack. Besides that, they are very weak, and SU-27M is always better.
So, overall, good map?
Yep.
I like it.
Yep.
Any other good maps you guys want to talk about, tactics-wise?
Hop and Glory.
Hop and Glory it is. That's actually just run down, it's very easy to scroll to. So, what makes you guys like this map?
Tank fights.
Yeah, lots of tank fights. There are some pockets where you can do a lot of intense tank fighting. One is right here. One sec, sorry. Those two areas have a lot of tank fighting. And up here. Lots of maneuver warfare. It's pretty open. There's relatively good cover in certain spots. Not too much, not too little. Overall, a very asymmetric map, but very nice nonetheless.
Yeah, because you do have, like, you got, like, this group of sectors and this group of sectors, and usually, like, this side controls this group, and then this side always attacks that group. So it's, like, kind of evenly distributed, yeah.
Yeah, something I really like about this map is that the two reinforcement sectors are on different sides, so that means you can attack, the right side can attack on top and the left side can attack on bottom because they're closer to the sectors with the reinforcement, so that's quite an advantage.
Yeah.
I doubt, like, when you said about this tank battles, when I look at it and when I play on it a bit, I find it... Like, wouldn't it be sort of hard to do tank battles on this map? Because it's so bloody open. You'd be susceptible to AT-UTM planes and AT-UTMs, would you?
No, you can still do them. I mean, if you shoot down the AT-UTM planes, there's only a limited amount of, you know, AT-UTM planes.
Yeah.
Once you
it's
get
a,
the
it's a lot easier on top.
Yeah. On the south, it's possible, because you've got that ridge area, this thing, blocking line of sight. So it's hard to use ATGM planes effectively, unless you've got recon, you know, hovering somewhere down here or down here to, you know, flank attack. This, hold on, let me just clear this. This area is all about infantry and mixed vehicle fights. That's a very important area on this map. The outer area, on the other hand, is all about ATGM vehicles, tanks, and so on.
I think a overshadowed part of this map a lot is this town here.
Pretty key to victory. If you hold that, you can actually attack into there. And reinforcing that area, if you're actually able to get into that city to the left side, is very, very difficult. Another thing about the map is this sector. Because of the river, you can't really get a wide concave and attack it from the upper area. If the enemy has that circled black zone, attacking that sector becomes even less likely. If you really want to cut that off, you'd have to go around from there and actually cut off the reinforcements. So very, very difficult.
Yeah, but
the map is a little bit lopsided for bigger games.
Yeah, but I mean, the main problem is also
This right here is it's a huge kill zone for the HGMs of the city, and then right here you have the river, so you can't attack from there. But once you have this little city, it's looking really good for you, because you can shoot at reinforcements and you can attack this forest, and once you have that, it's the city is down.
Yeah. Also, one very important facet of this map, let me just clear it, is this area. If you're the blue side, hypothetically speaking, and you cap that area, right, and the red side is sending reinforcements down this route, if you've got ATGM vehicles or ATGM troops, you can intercept everything that's going into that city.
Yeah, it's a very nice spot to be in if you're on blue side, but it's extremely hard to hold because the reinforcement point is so close.
Yeah,
means that once there's a little bit of fighting and you lose also some vehicles, the red side can just replace the things they lost, whereas you need to wait 1 to 2 minutes until your units come to the front line, and that's sometimes really painful if you run out of heavies or anti-air, your anti-air is a little weakened.
Yeah, from what
just,
I remember,
having a bad time.
I haven't played this that much after the balance patches, but it, from what I remember, it gets divided somewhere around here. Red side has such a source and easy access to this side of the forest that it's pretty much denied, not automatically, but very possibly.
What do you
and
gonna...
the airstrikes are obviously a theme, because you only have that little forest patches cover, nothing else.
What do you guys think about this map not having a string sector? Because it's evenly divided between sectors in this map. Like there's an even amount of sectors. Like with the other maps, there's always that run sector that can be, you know, captured by one team but can't by the other. What do you guys, does that really affect this map at all? There's no like string sector, no middle sector to really hold on to.
The zone layout is pretty good now. Anyone who played in beta will remember some big issues. The main issue with this map is the way they've designed their height map and their city areas, and the whole river being in the middle issue.
I don't mind the river too much on this map. Their maps are really very, very a lot worse. In this map, you have a huge open field, so even if the river wouldn't be there, I don't think I would be attacking much this way or this way. Just for the... Well, an argument can be made for attacking this way, but I don't know, I don't...
Yeah, the rivers don't intervene in the battle as much, this map.
Mm-hmm.
They're not hindering it so much.
Furthermore... Yeah. There are two most important zones on this map that decide the battle. This one, right here, and this one, right here. Those two, right there. Usually the north one is usually locked down by the red side. But the south one, which is, if I remember correctly, the echo sector, is what decides, if I remember correctly, the win on this map. It can go either way.
Yeah, so it's kind of evenly divided, even though there's no like middle point to control, because sector 1 and sector 2 are always going to be divided, and whoever controls that usually wins.
Yeah.
Okay, so overall, good map?
Definitely.
Yep.
Alright.
Very playable.
I'm personally not a big fan of this map, but I see where you guys are coming from, you know, I just find it really open, not really you can't really use the middle at all. That kind of ticks me off a little bit. But yeah.
In my opinion, middle actually is probably utmost crucial important, because if you start failing in one of those two zones or both, it can really decide the game. This one being a 2-point sector and controlling the town that Triumph just marked, you can control the entire reinforcement route to sector 1, and that can change the entire battle.
I mean, in my experience, this sector goes to red side, and then you can attack right here.
Yeah, and that's why...
Right here, and I mean, that's kind of in the middle, but you're definitely right, Rangro, in the beginning, or depending how it goes throughout the entire game, the fight is mostly on the sides.
Mm-hmm. And that's why if you get that town, that triumph mark, it can... really change that if you're mm-hmm. blue side, because and you can prevent that attack from coming from multiple directions.
You don't really get to do that to this sector if you are in blue due to that river, so it's a bit sad that the river is right there and has that big of an influence on the amount of choices you have for playing the lower end of the map according to the picture.
Okay, so any other good maps? Any other good maps that you guys like?
I like the one right below this one. Tough Jungle.
Yeah, oh, this is a nice map.
Mm-hmm. So, guys want to hot takes for this map?
One more thing about Hop and Glory before we leave that map. I think that thing can be also... added for 4v4. I think there is some possibility where it could be a lot of fun playing it 4v4.
It's a big map. You could do it.
Having big matches on that map, it ended up being a lot of fun. And it was very competitive.
Yeah, I mean, generally, most of the 2v2, 3v3 maps could easily be 4v4s, in my opinion. Most of them.
Are a few maps that would really add. You have Tropic Thunder moving up to 2v2, so it could be played as a 3v3. Nuclear Winter coming, being moved up to a 2v2 to be allowed as a 3v3 map. Hop and Glory, and then we have Tough Jungle. And if that went up to a 3v3, it could be played also as a 4v4, I think, with the way they've implemented their point settings.
I think Paddy Field as well needs to be bumped up, because that's seen a lot on 4v4s, and it's, I think, max 3,000 starting points.
I don't know. I mean, I prefer it like it is now. I would move some maps down. I don't. For example, Hope and Glory, I wouldn't really play it in a 3v3. I prefer it a lot in 2v2. I dislike it when there are too many units on a field. Then
that doesn't restrict you from playing 2v2. Enables people play 4v4 on it.
If anything, I think under 3v3, you start getting really too small for that map.
The on Hop 4v4s in beta had these like wide sweeping maneuvers. It's basically everything that players asked for from ALB for big games. It turned out to be really, really fun. For just 2v2, 3v3, or 4v4. I'd love to play 4v4 with a standard points count. One of the few maps that could go any way.
If it's reroll for 3v3, it can be still done for 2v2, 1v1, and so on and so forth. But I think minimum it needs to be rerolled for 3v3 because it's such a big map. I've played this on 2v2 myself. It is a lot of fun on 2v2 as well. There is no doubt about it. But the size of the map does not justify it being locked into a 2v2. It's too
big
for... You
can't play it in 3v3, you can't play it in 4v4.
No, you can. You can, but the problem is you don't get the points, the 1,000 points per player.
Oh.
That's what I mean. So if you have it rolled as a 3v3 map, right, you still have the points for 2v2, but you can bump the points up to do a 4v4 as well.
Oh yeah, sure, why not?
I think of, like, just all the maps in general. Why not just make it so you can choose the amount of starting points you want? Just
there
for
are
all
some
of
maps
them.
That are absolutely horrible for that. Like, who would want to play a 4v4 on Chosen Reservoir? That'd never be close to competitive.
But just giving you, yeah, option to do it, be fun. Not all of them have to be super competitive.
In trying to jump into a game and having to have an argument about a game turning into a clown game with a host, that is so bad. And having to go and host your own game instead of being able to jump into something that is somewhat competitive doesn't always do the trick to host your own game. Sometimes you just want to jump in there, get into the optimal play.
Fair enough. Fair enough. So, tough jungle. One down below. Guys, got anything to say about this map?
I like the positioning of the side spawns. I like playing middle there as well. Seems pretty even. Anyone else had competitive threes on that?
Yeah, I really enjoyed this map in 2v2s and 3v3s. I found this map quite a lot of fun.
I only played it in 2v2, but as you said, the good thing about it is that blue side will get those two sectors, and then red side will have a spawn much closer, so red side is going to be attacking on this side and vice versa on the other side. So there's going to be some movement in the game, and that's very nice.
Yeah, the only issue
I've ever had with this map, on red side attacking down from the north end down towards southeast, you have this like industrial compound there, and I find that can sometimes really determine this entire sector if you get that.
Yeah, but I mean, you also have the city right here, so I mean, you can decap it, but taking that sector is quite a pain sometimes.
I've had a lot of fun playing this general area. Just ATGMs, small pushes with island hopping. Some fun tank gameplay. Actually having to walk command infantry into there can result in good gameplay.
This map seems really like reminiscent of the old AOB maps because it isn't big, but there's still a bit of room to maneuver, and just the aesthetic of it being, you know, just forestry. There's a lot of forests to hang out in, and you got these two giant just dead end spaces here to do crazy flanks with.
It's actually pretty easy to cover those two areas with OHs or a few scout helos. I find that most of the fun happens around the middle or along these two lines, as mentioned earlier. The buildings in mid are pretty interesting. Mm-hmm. Actually getting like sappers and other sorts of infantry into them.
Yeah, because they have
small industrial blocks. They work differently than a large city.
Yeah, because that mid is nice and like sectored out, so you got one side or bottom side cap in that and top side cap in this. So you kind of got these two, like, two cities, two towers fighting against each other and kind of being the mainstay of the map. If you can control both of them, usually control middle.
Also, there's a flavor coming in from this side. Mm-hmm. You actually find players going down that flank and doing fun things. I don't think that happens from red sector in.
Because it's too narrow on the other side, it seems. Like, you don't have as much room.
It takes a lot of time to get over there for what appears to be a small return.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of walking infantry along the line I just made.
Well, you can lock down this. There's a city over here that you can lock down once you get around. That is if you've secured this area and of course, the whole forest. But I have seen players actually do that to great effect, just locking down that area so that, you know, you bog down the enemy by, you know, ATGMs or whatever. As soon as he spawns, he's got a problem to deal with on his flank, and it restricts his movements a lot.
I'd love to play this on a standard points 4v4. I think it'd be a lot of fun.
Why do you want always so much starting points?
I just want actually, standard.
I think this would be a nice map for 1v1 actually. Maybe make all the sectors a one pointer, and I think then it would be very nice for 1v1.
Seems a bit too very big for 1v1 maybe. Oh, okay, I see where you're coming from.
I don't know. Maybe it is.
Cause especially those hill flanks, because I can see a lot of cheesy play going around those hill flanks, as you can't cover both of them cost effectively.
There's too many sectors, maybe. I think, for one versus one. You've got 9 sectors, including your home spawns, right? And generally speaking, if you're taking the base CV, which is 100 points, you get 6 of them. you lose one CV or, you know, or so, you're done, you're cooked. And...
Well, you can have many CVs in one deck. I have like
yeah, but I'm just talking generally speaking.
13 or something in my one deck, 1v1 deck. I mean, you just need to get more enough of them. I have 3 cards of CV
more
in my 1v1 deck. Standard,
but
I think.
But for a 1v1 sort of scenario, I think there's too many zones. I think if they cut it by maybe one, maybe two zones, then I can see it being actually really good for 1v1.
I think the 1v1 version of this map is Punjin Valley.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have a very similar map layout.
Well, I kind of just want to go a bit to the side here, because every time we're talking about these maps and what makes them good, it's always about the infantry sectors. It seems like the infantry sectors make or break a map. Would you agree? Like the towns and the cities.
What do you mean
and the...
by infantry sector?
If you hold an infantry sector, you usually control the sector. Like, I mean, if you control like a town or a city or something like that, if you put infantry inside of them, usually you're gonna win that sector, and it seems a lot of these maps you base your strategies around holding these towns and infantry places. Would you agree?
Well, they make choke points, but on maps that have forest islands, you can do tank pushing and other fun stuff like that.
But you're right. Infantry sectors or towns at choke points, as Triumph mentioned, do play a very big role in a lot of the maps.
But what makes him so, like, good? What makes you want to control them? Just for people who don't know, what makes these infantry sectors so lucrative to have holding these towns and industrial sectors?
Well, the enemy cannot traverse on those roads. You effectively lock down roads. You know, you don't allow the enemy to come across. You just sit there, and you could flank them. You block him off from an entire sector, so then he has to go off-road or do something completely different, for which you can plan, obviously. But the primary thing is just lock off an area.
Mm-hmm. Because you can just plop in ATGM infantry and AA infantry and just basically be a giant circle of denial.
Also, it's a forward-looking post. You can actually see enemy movement and positioning and maneuvers and so on.
Do you guys think it's good having a lot of these maps and a lot of, like, who wins the map by controlling the infantry sectors? Do you think that's good for map balance, or should it be more about the tanks and vehicles holding sectors?
It's not only about infantry sectors. It comes into, you know, it's part of a larger scheme of things. It's not just infantry sectors. They do play a big role, but having an infantry sector alone is not going to win you the game. You know, you need to have vehicles play their part, tanks play their part. It's just depending on what the situation calls for.
Okay, fair enough. Like, I just find it that a lot of maps, it's all about holding, like, those towns and cities. It's always about trying to get, rush there first. Because if you get first ground in there, it's easy to defend, and then you can push the enemy.
That will happen when you have a river separating the map, like cutting it in half. You have a river, which means a bridge. The bridge is a choke point, and then you have the town acting as another way to choke, or as a small fortress that the enemy can keep feeding into with more ease than you can.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We now get to 38 parallel.
Okay, before we get to Yat map, anyone else got any good map suggestions? Or good maps?
I got a horrible map suggestion. The worst map in the game suggestion.
Who's that one for now?
Oh, I got one of those as well.
The one right under this, Chosen Reservoir.
No, come on. They're way worse.
For any big game, it is just not fun. The middle is okay, but right, I never want to play that sector.
Do we have another good one, or should we move on to the bad
ones? I got one good one that I want to talk about, and that's the land version of D-Day. We could just scroll down to that one. It's a bit downwards. Yeah, another D-Day in Paradise, the land version. Well, it's still the naval version in this run, but it doesn't really matter. Just ignore these two sectors. They do not exist.
I absolutely hate this map.
On land?
Another D-Day in Paradise or Gunboat Diplomacy?
Another D-Day. On land. No naval part of it involved.
Okay. Because I'm seeing your marks on Gunboat, that's why.
No, right, no? I didn't put... Really? On yeah. Mine it shows it on D-Day. Like, do you see those marks on D-Day?
Yeah, I see them in Gunboat as well.
Same here.
Okay, that's yeah, really same. Weird. Okay, because I was just rubbing out their, let's clear mark up. Do you still see it? Because I'm doing it on D-Day.
I don't see anything on D-Day.
I see you on Gunboat.
Gunboat.
I'll make a mark yeah. for D-Day.
Yeah, I'm seeing that on Gunboat as well. That's weird. Because, okay, let's just scroll down to D-Day and let's hope it will work. But I think this is... Like Bloody Ridge and Paddy Field, I think it's a very even map. You got three distinct lanes. You got the right side, like mountain, you can put infantry through. You got the middle for tank plays and ATGM stuff, and then the left side is nice close quarters combat with a middle intersection town that's quite fun to hold. Do you guys like this map at all?
Personally, all right. I like it. I find some interesting fights on it.
Mm-hmm.
I like the tile set.
I mean, like the aesthetic and how it looks.
Yeah.
I think the aesthetics are nice. Having played maybe around 50 games on it, I find it an interesting map. Sometimes it's not always the most fun map. It can become a very big grind fight that gets very tiring after about 15-20 minutes, but it's a fun map.
Mm-hmm. Because this is personally one of my favourite maps. I think it's pretty good for if competitive play, but I don't see many people really playing it all too often.
Well, it is in the ranked rotation for 2v2, but I have a little bit of a problem right here. Because, well, that's
so
tough
on Gunboat, that's really weird. Try doing it below D-Day. Like, do it on Atto Abound in roughly the same area.
Well, I don't think... Let me see... Here. And... Anyway, I'll describe it. You see the two sectors in the left?
Yeah.
Top left. There are two sectors. Mm-hmm. One side should get each, but... You attack both with helos, you will meet between the lower sector and the city. Mm-hmm. So, well, a couple buildings which are between the two sectors. So, red side has an advantage. It's faster here, and generally, if both teams are equally as good as the other, the fight is going to be in the lower sector.
What about, like, do you guys have any special strategies for going down the right side mountain area and middle?
Flamethrowers, flamethrowers, flamethrowers.
Yeah, Navy SEALs, leech on spets, not...
Yeah, I mean, if you're blue 4, you need Navy SEALs. If you're red 4, you need flamethrowers and RPOs.
Because it is very hilly at right side, and it allows you to do a lot of maneuver warfare with infantry across that mountain.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to show up, but in between those two sectors with the mountains and in between the middle sector, there's that narrow patch of mm-hmm. woods.
Yeah, you can
and
see
I find it. That can also turn into a very huge slaughter fest mm-hmm. between infantry.
A narrow path of death. And middle? I usually find middle to be a pretty standard tank play. Lots of tanks back and forth, few ATGMs down at... Right where it reaches a canal, that canal, a lot of ATGMs usually go back and forth between you, along the canal.
Yeah, I find it interesting for tanks, and I also find that the small patches of woods above the middle zone can be quite interesting for different flanking routes and stuff to get behind enemy forces.
Yeah, I just think it's a pretty well-balanced map, and yeah, we can all sort of agree on that. Any rebuttals?
I think it's not as balanced as it could be, but it's one of the more balanced maps in the game, definitely.
Mm-hmm.
Agreed. I think it's not the best balance, but it's fun.
I'm not gonna play it.
Yeah, I don't have an opinion on it. I personally don't like the map at all.
So
no, I haven't played it too much either. I played it in beta a couple of times, but it didn't really stand out to me.
Okay, so no one has any other suggestions for any good maps?
I think we've run out, Rang.
I think we've run out. Okay, yeah. So now we get to the fun part, the bad maps, and I think it's good if we start with Father's Unholy Spirit, 38th parallel.
So really?
Yeah.
Don't like that one?
No.
I don't think it's a bad map. It's an alright map, but it's definitely not the worst map, by far.
It's but too deadlock.
Yeah,
it's ruined
the thing
by
is,
the river in the middle.
The blue side has got a significant advantage over the red side on this map. Like, really significant advantage.
Yeah.
You could just blitz down this road in here, take over the city, napalm this area, and that's it. You have completely screwed them.
But how would you, if that's actually one of the best strategies, then as red side you just could throw some napalm on the bridge and then get some SAS and helos or some anti-air helos, and then this strategy completely fails.
Well, napalm doesn't really slow down units like it used to in ALB. You'll get worried and shaken,
yeah,
but it won't slow you down.
Well, yeah, but you'll take damage and you will have bad morale, and then you meet the enemy and you kind of get fucked then.
Yeah, but the thing is, if you meet the enemy, right, you would have napalmed him too. And you're not going to be meeting the enemy, you'll be going behind this area.
But
this road,
the front line is going to be right here, right? Or what you
By the way,
suggest...
guys, I think you have the same color on. You're both red.
Yeah, let me change it. What did I take? What isn't
You are pink.
I am pink? No,
yeah,
I'm not.
I have it.
Well, not right now.
Green is good.
Green? Yeah. No, I'm colorblind, blind, red, green. How about this one?
Good.
That's green.
Yeah, I'm different enough, or?
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Alright, so basically you'll have a front line right here. And you have problem with supply because, I don't know, I don't think it's a good idea to go over the river in the middle. Do it on the sides, but...
Well, the thing is this, if you're blitzing down the middle, you're immediately putting the enemy on the back foot. And again, this depends what setup you've got. Are you playing a 2v2? Or are you playing a 3v3, 4v4? Right? That's entirely dependent. Now, I'm talking about it from a 3v3 or a 4v4 aspect of it. I'm not talking about 2v2, because I personally do not do many 2v2s. But from a 3v3, 4v4 aspect of it, while you're blitzing down the bridge and you get behind this area, right? This area offers you quite a bit of cover. Yes, the reinforcement route is hard to get to, but if you've got amphibious units, you could just cross over constantly.
What units?
LVTPs with the Marines, the V-150 with Delta Force. You can get through quite easily. I've done it multiple times against teams and so on as well. And you just napalm this area right here and shift your infantry as far up to this point as possible, and you've effectively, you know, got a good stranglehold on that area. Meanwhile, while you're doing this, it's going to take about two guys to shut you down from doing this. Meanwhile, your teammates...
I don't agree.
Okay, go ahead.
Alright. How do we do this? Do you finish or do I address this
let
now?
Just let him finish and then rebuttal.
No. Address it right now so we can have a back and forth. Go on.
Alright. So basically, look at this distance. It's like about a third of what you get from the other side, right?
Right.
So you're already at a disadvantage if the fight goes for somewhat long time. And I don't know, I mean, if it's really a good strategy and the other team is aware it's a good strategy, they can just throw napalm on the bridge, alright?
Yeah.
So you can't really get fast wheeled vehicles over the bridge.
As I mentioned before, napalm will not slow the vehicles down.
Unless you're willing to throw about over 200 points away on napalm, it's really not that effective. I mean, look at Bloody Ridge. People have napalmed me almost every game when I try to take that town, and it really doesn't determine the end of that town.
Yeah, but I mean, you still are then in a bad shape, and let's say the enemy
you're in a worse shape, but it's two guys against one. The napalm really isn't going to make it equal.
All right, yeah. I mean, if you have two times the forces of the enemy, then in this area you're gonna beat them. But that's the whole point. Creates
it's a
also
rush.
Problems for the other side. And what if the enemy has forces which are going both this? Who are going this way, so he can redirect a lot of them.
And that's why we're talking about a 3v3, 4v4 scenario, not 2v2. 3v3, 4v4
yes,
scenario, you can cover, one guy can cover, you know, this zone, another guy can cover this zone, right? So it kind of evens itself out. Now, if you've got two guys blitzing down this area at the very get-go, right, it's incredibly effective. I've done it a lot of times against good teams as well. And works, surprisingly works really well, because what happens is they get bogged down. It's a psychological thing. You know, they look at it, they're like, oh my god, they're already over on our side. And so they just keep chucking resources while your flanks are able to expand and go around and do whatever's needed, even if you're grinding in that area.
I don't know.
I mean,
do you plan on getting this as well, or?
It's not that hard to get that once you have the town. It's actually quite easy.
Yeah, but I mean,
the
so
thing
far,
is, once
say...
you get that town, you can easily expand into this town, and you can start just hopscotching all the way over, and you have an entire line of towns now that are completely under your control, and you shut them down very easily.
What happens if they do a helo drop in this town? So basically, when you're crossing the river, there are also already like four Hodurans and
anyone
maybe two SAS in there.
A big game gets destroyed by bombers. You have to invest way too much ASF to stop like mass bomber.
Yeah, I mean, generally on this map, since it's split in half, the only I don't want to say cost efficient, but the only reasonable attack is from the middle. Everything else just takes too much dedication and points. You have to either do a huge helo assault from one side, which isn't really that fast or that effective compared to the center area. Mm-hmm. Plus, if it's not followed up with anything, then it's just in woods or buildings. It's not going to last for very long. But once you have that bridgehead open with the city, can bring your own heavies there. Amphibious assaults aren't really gonna work because on the outskirts, let's say from this area to this area, amphibious assaults aren't really a question because you can, I mean, having autocannon recon and ATGM pretty much shuts that down.
Yeah, water crossing only works right near the start. You can try to go somewhere along like this road into there if you know that someone's rushing in mid. Besides that, to really set up an attack, it takes a long time to get to a far flank. Kind of disappointed that the map does not have side spawns. Just would make things a lot more fun for a big game.
Yeah, I'm also speaking from mostly 4v4, 3v3 experience here, so Random might have a different perspective on 2v2s on this map than I, so...
I think...
No, I mean, also for 3v3 and 4v4, I mean, I guess once you have the city, it's that's quite nice, but I kind of doubt you would get it.
And
I've had it done to me, Random, I've had it done to me by some really good players, right? And what I noticed was I was not able to get up to this area fast enough. You know, that tip, I was not able to get up here fast enough before they were able to blitz in, reinforce consistently, and shut down, you know, any sort of airstrikes. Because, you know, a lot of, you know, anti-air units are amphibious. You could just plonk them right here, you know, anything that just comes over to bomb you will only make a one-way trip, most likely. And it's very hard to shoot those anti-air units because there's a slight depression into the water, right? It's very hard to target them. So, I mean, I've had it done to me by some really good players. And then I've adopted that strategy and I've tried it myself multiple times and it works very successfully. Yeah.
Because it with the cyan area.
Yeah, and also, one thing with this map is also that since the bridges and rivers are pretty much, well, not impossible, but very hard to attack over later on, then you can pretty safely get quite a lot of commands in. And if the other guy doesn't buy, let's say, two commands less than you, then you can pull up a big lead in a couple of minutes that the other guy will not get back later on.
Also, one very important factor in this map is amphibious assaults and where to do them. This is a very good area to do amphibious assaults. This bush area coming across, right? Because there is nothing that could really target you unless it's sitting right here. And that too, it's a little too far. That's one good area to do an amphibious assault. Another area is here. This is also a very good area for an amphibious assault.
The other side has one place dropped in an arrow on it.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah, but when you're playing against good players, these holes usually get plucked down and they don't... When the game is like 20 to 30 minutes in, it's really hard to pull off anything amphibious anymore.
Yeah.
It's definitely sending APCs over the line which has tanks and autocannons just doesn't work.
Personally, I find this map just really boring. When every time I play this map, it's always been a really boring, campy affair. Like, you do have that rush into middle, but most of the time it turns into a stalemate. And then up top and at bottom, those like two sectors on those four at bottom and those four up top, I find those also to be pretty long stalemates as you just camp the bridges, put some recon across the river, and you can usually stop any assault. And then because it's neutralized in the middle, no one's really gaining any points. And it's just a bloody waiting for the time with the tick down. And that's what happens really every single time I play this map. None of these like rushes or these rushes never usually work, as I always see napalm. Just by phantom, you see a bunch of stuff going across the river or across the bridge, napalm. And you can usually stop those nasty little assaults.
I found that besides the middle that we had the conversation about, it's just you attack your left flank, you defend your right.
Mm-hmm. It's just...
Yeah, it's a really stagnant and... basically, the river ruins it.
Yeah.
If there wasn't the river, this would have been so much more fun.
Mm-hmm.
But they just went bananas with the amphibious stuff and...
Totally.
It would be great if they had the river dried up just for a terrain feature.
Yeah, that's actually not a bad idea. Also, making the bridges thicker, or I mean, you know, wider. The bridges are just way too thin.
Mm-hmm.
Way too thin. Something that add in DLC, a new bridge model. We don't need a new airplane or tank. We need a new bridge.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if you guys said it, but like, when bridges get blocked, that's just horrible.
I've actually seen people do it deliberately, where you take like 8T34s and you can block any bridge in the game, and they can't be moved out of the way. That's and something strategy. Like, let's say Apocalypse Imminent, it becomes almost impossible to ever get back into the center and ever win.
So this is another just side question. Do you think rivers and bridges add really anything to maps? Do you think they make them better, or do you think they make them worse?
When it's along
besides
the river,
negative? I mean, the only thing they add is negative, I think.
I almost completely agree. I mean, on some maps where they're one not in the center and two not really important. I mean, it's all right to have a few choke points, but if it's like this, all in the middle, it's completely terrible.
Yeah. They add maybe 5 or 10% to the game, but 90% is just negative.
If they're around the one-third point or of the map, then that's fine. Yeah, you have to cross one between the middle and your home, fine. But when it's cut down the middle, like this map or Hop and Glory, not very fun.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's down to the bridges get clogged up and blocked. You can't really do amphibious assaults later on in the game. It's just suicide. You can't, if you fight across the river with just BTRs or LVTP, it's not going to work. You're not going to win a battle with those.
Because they're lightly armored and they can't really fight back.
Yeah, it's just creating choke points for nothing.
Mm-hmm. I find it rivers, when they go down a map vertically, like this, when it cuts a map in half between both sides, yeah, not fun. But let's say, I'm going to clear this up, let's say we put a river down here, let's say there's a river down here. I find that to be a lot more fun as the river, like, not cutting the map in half, like, vertically, but when it cuts the map in half horizontally. Because you can use amphibious assaults, you can use amphibious units to get back and forth, let's just say, between both sides, for example, real fast. You can use them as sort of a shortcut instead of an attacking force. And being able to use amphibious units is more taking shortcuts across areas where normal units can't. I think I'd be a better way to using them instead of just making them having to attack across the river, because my George, you're not going to get across the river with amphibious assault. You're not going to win any matches by doing an amphibious assault.
Or, here's another good solution. Why not re-roll this entire map where one team spawns here and the other team spawns here?
Yeah, that'd be a great way to do it.
Because
it'd just be like requirements and yeah, just having it cut down through in the middle, it's a lot more fun because you can just cut in between.
I can't remember the name of the map that was in the Airline Battle.
Christian
that was like that, but that was actually quite fun.
Christian
with the hills on both sides. Yes, that map.
Yeah,
that was actually quite fun.
Yeah, it was an awesome map. Awesome map.
Fun, but it had its issues.
Oh yeah, it definitely had its issues, but it was at least a fun map. This is, I mean, even if you're winning, you're really not having fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, and with the nature of this map, this often turns into just an RT duel. When you can't attack anywhere, you can't really move your armor anywhere. Okay, I'm gonna buy smirches, atacams, buratino, stuff like that. So it just stagnates and goes into this arty camp best.
And the fun in the game is having your cost-effective armor able to push with your infantry. If you can't do that, you're not gonna have a lot of fun.
So, any other bad maps you guys want to talk about?
Apocalypse Imminent.
Okay,
it's the worst one, I think.
Go to that.
Yeah, that's not a good map either.
Okay, I got it. Wait, oh no, I don't.
So,
okay, now I do.
It's another map where you have rivers cutting things, and you're never going to cross. Like, right here, that line. You have one bridge, but if you want a river cross to work, you need jungle or like city block right on the edge. So that way you could actually gain a foothold. Having to go and cross into jungle from open ground, you're gonna die.
See, the silliness of this is if you try to cross from here to here over the bridge, right? There's a bush right here, right? Anything that comes over the river is gonna be killed by whatever's in that bush. That bush needs to either go or, I don't know. I mean, it's just not good. Not good at all. And the same thing happens when you try to cross from the other side. There's a city right there and there's a bush as well. So, plus, I would also say this zone needs to be a two-pointer. It slows down the game way too much if it's a one-pointer.
Yeah, maybe it would make it a little better, but I don't know. I really dislike it. Once you have a sector, you pretty much won't lose it unless you took one off the other side of the river, and
Like this one, it's just a huge rush in the beginning, or you just get lots of flame MLRS, and once you get this point right up, I don't think you lose it again. It's very hard to take it back.
Yeah,
it's just not gonna make a fun game.
It's enough for one of those maps, it's fair to just like boil in the entire water side of this map and just make it all land. I think it'd be a bit better, or a lot better.
Yep.
Is that river? Because it also is map. There's hardly any bridges on this map compared to 30. You've got one here, and here. Not entirely too many, especially for left side. You only really got two places, or I guess three places, but no one goes across up there. That takes way too long. Do you hardly have any like entrance rays into the middle delta sector? That's delta usually.
And that's why if you face someone who actually clogs the bottom two bridges, this game becomes just so boring. It's just, you then can't even move across the river. You can't even try to move across the river.
Yes.
And yeah, as Random said, the city area here, it's just a bait for Buratino or Chinese MLRS. It's...
Because you can easily just sit on the other side here, and just burn Dino your right to victory.
Yeah, basically.
It's a boring map overall. Yeah. Really bad design.
I don't see what they could do with like zones alone to fix it. It's just a map that you're not going to play.
You can switch it upside down, like we said before, like. Make a spawn here, you make a spawn here, and up here, and maybe up here or something. But that you could do that, then it would be a little more interesting.
Definitely.
So you could say this map is a bit of an apocalypse.
Yeah, to say the least.
It suffers from the same problem as 38th Parallel. When I look at this map and I look at 38th Parallel, it's like the same thing. All over again.
This is like its little brother, pretty much.
Back to Incheon is another one that's like it.
Hey, want to scroll down to, want to talk about Back to Incheon?
Yeah.
A very wide map.
I kind of like his map.
Not a bad map. But there's only two viable zones, or three maybe viable zones. That you can attack from. This area, because there are two areas to enter from, and you could possibly enter from here, or do an amphibious sort of thing from here to here. It's very, very stagnant. You know, you can't move a lot. Again, because of the bridges and the damn rivers that are just everywhere.
I actually think the problem with this map really is if you're coming from blue side, there's really no way to attack that right side because that peninsula there's a village here and you can easily lock that down. So really that right side's easier for red to attack.
Yeah, blue has a better chance to attack here.
This zone here and get into the forest here, and that on the same time red really can't push into blue side from there. So it pretty much becomes the two contested zones of the two circled in black, and it just becomes way too stagnant. It's just not fun.
Yeah, I can see because it also has that river going down the middle once again, dusting off a lot of attacks.
Yeah.
I think another thing that a lot of people miss about this map is that you can actually do some pretty sneaky helicopter rushes down here, or down these both sides. If you can get a couple of helicopter infantry, you got a town here, in a town here, you can garrison, and because it's sort of off the beaten path and you got a lot of water space open, it's pretty easy to move logistics and amphibious units.
Anyone that allows you to do that is not playing it correctly. if you're putting that much of your economy into this area, or that area, you deserve to get crushed someplace else.
Also, definitely. The counter to it is only about 100 to 200 points. It's just like Floods, you know, two man pads and an AA piece with a recon helicopter, and that's already locked down.
At most, it's annoying.
Yeah, that's it. It's really just a nuisance. But you end up putting maybe half of what they put.
should just end up, like, immediately punishing you.
That's not really a viable point, not a viable strategy to really
like,
do
if
yet.
If there was a way to hop, like, APCs with an island chain, then maybe there'd be a strategy, but overall, if you have open water, and this applies to the map floods as well, and you try to go amphibious or helicopters, you're probably going to have a bad time.
You're going to be bombed into oblivion.
But, I mean, you can do it in the late game. You can get, like, 400, 500, 600 points of helicopters and just rush it and hope you kill the AA, which is there, and the CV. And right behind your blob of helis, you have a helicopter with a CV infantry. So that will give you plus 4 for a couple minutes. You'll get a couple points like this. I don't know, if there is 200 points of anti-air, you can forget it, and definitely a good idea to get some AA in the late game on this map.
Banking on the enemy sleeping, pretty much.
Yeah. I mean, it's mainly, you know, even if you put 600 points in, it's only a 200-point counter that shuts it down. It's just, it's completely not cost-efficient.
One recon helicopter here will shut down everything.
Yeah.
Not even a recon helicopter, you can have it be like a recon LAV or something.
Yeah, but I mean, you can shoot it down with planes, and then if they don't replace it, might be a rush coming. But yes, if they see it early enough, you can forget it.
Okay. Any other bad maps? Or maps that you guys dislike?
Oh, worst map? One of the worst maps, Maze in Japan, right under it. Oh, horrible.
Oh yeah, yes, Ron.
What were they thinking when they made this?
We gotta make an infantry map, guys.
Someone who likes infantry fighting, this map is horrible.
Like, I just had 10 and 15 point armor rolling up and down the hills. Then it's, do you crest the ridge? If so, you get shot. If not, you wait for the enemy to get shot when they jump over.
And the cover zones are not depicted properly. You'll have bushes and stuff, but you don't have cover in them. It's just really badly done. This is a all-round horrible map.
Mm-hmm. It looks bloody chaotic, because you got all these, like, small, narrow arrays. It looks like a maze, to be honest. You can't really find your way around all too easily. And it's just, you need to use infantry, but the map is so big, it's hard to spread out all your infantry everywhere.
Yeah.
I mean, this map is probably one that was made by a graphics artist and made some pretty mountains and forests, and then they slapped some sectors on it and called it a map.
Yeah, it does look a bit very messy. Very messy.
I'm just not going to play Maze in Japan, but a map I do not enjoy is Cold War Z.
Cold War Z, that's just
it
down
feels
below a bit.
Like I'm playing something very similar to Maze in Japan if I'm playing online. But the thing is, this has side spawns, and they do not add anything to the map. One side is just a total choke. It's choke hell. Mm-hmm. Choke point hell. The other side is kind of open. Feels like Maze in Japan, where you can move units across forests. But overall, have not had any fun on that map.
The sectors, they're so few, and they're so big. Because, like, you're not really going to capture a lot of these sectors. They're going to be neutralized, because you're going to have an enemy here, and you're going to have your CV here, and, like, here and here, here and here. Or just roughly, yeah. It seems like it's a map that's just going to be a neutralized middle, and very boring. And this is meant to be a 4v4 map. It's not really all that big for 4v4. It's big, but there's not really enough attacking places for 4v4.
The huge mountain on the right side of the picture and the side spawns don't add anything to it. I hope that they update it, get rid of the spawns, and then it might be playable.
This is like Maze in Japan. It looks like a bloody mess.
I don't think I ever had a fun game on this.
I have. I've had a fun game. I kind of understand the whole point of the map. But yeah, I don't see it being played for competitive play properly. I mean, it's just a mess. It's not straightforward. It's just a mess completely.
A bit of a side note. What would you guys say? What are like the main things that make a map competitive? What would be like just the main main ideas that a map should have to make it competitive?
It has to be balanced and bonus points if the gameplay is somewhat dynamic. For example, say on the right side you have one sector which blue 4 gets first and the other, like one side there's a sector which blue 4 gets first there, but somewhat close to this is a reinforcement point to red 4, to where red 4 gets first. So in the course of the game, red 4 will probably take the sector which is actually closer to the main spawn of blue 4, and on the other side exact opposite.
Yeah, basically I would say also.
You cut out Mystic.
Sorry, I just wanted to say that random is quite correct. It basically also comes down to distances, right? Distances from each side matter. Like, if you're going to get there within a minute, and the enemy is going to get there within a minute 30, that's actually a problem on a map like Cliffhanger, where you get to the central zone on Cliffhanger probably 20 or 25 seconds after the enemy gets there. And therefore, you know, that map is imbalanced. Or unbalanced, sorry. And this kind of applies to a lot of the maps in the game. The distances need to match to a very large extent. Maybe 5 seconds here and there, that's fine. Also, if we scroll up to Bloody Ridge, which is a very big problem on this map, which we did not address. Is everyone on Bloody Ridge?
I am.
Okay, on Bloody Ridge, say for example, you want to call out something here. Okay? What'll happen is units will come out of here, they'll drive all the way down here and they'll come there, somewhere around. They'll take some sort of route like that. Similarly, if you want to call something out over here, sometimes what'll happen is they'll come from here all the way around. It's like totally reversed. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't take their logical path, you know, from the left or from the right. They're going across the map, which leads to a lot of confusion.
Actually, if I may just modify your route a little bit, the real issue, they actually go that way, and they go right into the enemy ATGMs. And then you look over and you're like, what happened to that really expensive heavy tank? Where'd that go?
My Charlie 2, no!
Yeah, and it gets sideshot, and you won't even have a chance to reverse it, unless the person in the center gives you way plenty of time.
We can make
Are central towns and places that make up the game, then the time needs to be equal on both sides to get there with helos approximately and vehicles, because it just gives a huge advantage if you're there already setting and the other guy's just rolling up. It already puts you on the back foot.
Having wonky reinforcement routes really hurts newbies. Mm-hmm. They make the argument that, it increases actions or increases the amount of planning you have to do. But for newer players, absolutely destroys their day when 100 plus points of infantry or tank rolls right into the enemy and they have no idea why.
Go ahead.
And on a lot of the maps, it shouldn't even be too hard to get the distances right, because if you start with wheeled vehicles, say from here and here, then you just measure the distance or the time that it takes to get to the town, for instance. I'm just using this as an example. Then correct. You can just move the sector up a tiny bit, so you can start a bit earlier, so that it's so that there would be at least very close. They don't have to be same by the second, but some of the maps have like this merit advantage when you start from the other side. You are just going to get there faster with wheeled vehicles.
I think the area unmarked has about a 5-10 second advantage getting into middle. They'll be like right about that mark when the enemy is around this area. Not very fun.
I find a good just like makeshift fakes I usually do. So let's say I want to call a unit. Let's say I want a unit to go over here, for example. And if I was to just put my mouse over here and click and he does like his silly route, instead I would do like, I'd make him call him over here. And then so once he gets here, I'll have to click him again to move up forward. It means you have to do more action to move up my units, but it makes so they don't go through any silly things. So by calling my units behind my front lines instead of around my front line jar, I find it to help a lot more. Just as a makeshift threat or a, just a way to sort of get around it at the moment.
Oh, absolutely. So that is the way to get around it.
What do you want to do? Do you want to make them use the other spawn point, or?
I think it'd be a cool idea to just be able to turn off a spawn point for yourself. Let's say, like, I click this arrow. I click it. It goes grayed out for me. So then my units will not spawn from here when I do spawn. Just like some sort of easy way to turn off spawn points for yourself. Sorry, Triumph?
A decent rally point system upon calling a unit in. If you're able to shift-click rally along the road, that'd be perfect.
That'd be great, just because, yeah, that does annoy me a lot. But I'm not as high-skilled as you guys, and I lose a lot of my units by a move up. Oh, there goes all my infantry, because I ran into ATGM fire, and I wasn't looking for a brief second. Because I took the silly route long way in, right in front of all the enemy tanks.
If you want to change the sector your units spawn from, I mean, you can kind of do that. You just... First thing you do is you put the ghost of the unit down in the sector, and then you drag it to where you want to actually go, and then it will spawn from the sector in which you dropped it. So for example, you can...
Well, the big point is right, that's a workaround, adapting to the game, rather than the game having a clean design.
Quite anymore.
Yeah, are there any other bad maps you guys want to go over real fast?
There's too many. I mean, we could spend till tomorrow talking about the bad maps, but I think we've outlined the good ones.
So comparing just the good maps to the bad maps, it seems there's a lot more bad maps than good maps. Would you have to agree?
Well, let's ask everyone what the percentage of bad maps would be. Bubba, you want to go first?
How many maps are there in total?
I believe it's 34. 34 maps. That's also including naval maps as well.
I would say that there are maybe 4 or 5.
Now that's not good for a game. When you have a game with a lot of maps, you expect all of them to be pretty good and fun to play. But when you only have 3 or 4 maps that's actually any decent, and then the rest of them not being good for, like, balanced play, that's not entirely good, you have to agree.
I think everyone wants a good map design.
Yeah, I would even like metrical maps. Because those, Fool the Gap and stuff like that, they were really good maps to play on. Escalation. For at least tournament games, they give the best outset for a fair match.
Yeah,
I don't know, maybe...
They
wouldn't have to do many of them, but like 1 or 2 symmetrical maps would be enough. And one of the biggest issues is, like, as I said, to try to get the driving times and flying times to certain places the same for both sides. I mean, that shouldn't be too hard to do. Just like I drew before, you can just expand the sector a little bit and there you go. You start a bit earlier and you get there a bit faster.
Guys, I gotta go for a couple minutes, but it's been nice talking to you guys about this.
Okay, take it easy, Mystic.
Likewise.
Yeah, I mean the arrival times are extremely important, and I mean they don't asymmetrical balance. It's all right if it's done very precise and stuff. So, for example, it's okay if one side has a disadvantage on the left if they have advantage of about equal size on the right, or if they have like on their side of the of a sector on the right. Buildings and very nice defensive position, then it's all right. But if just one side has an advantage, then it's not very good.
Yeah, completely agree with you there. Asymmetrical stuff is done well. It's really interesting and fun, but they really don't seem to have it down in Red Dragon, in my opinion.
Do you guys think
There's one big thing. You want to have a very even middle sector of a map, but the left and right lanes can be asymmetrical.
I don't think it's the middle needs to be even. I mean, it can be in the middle, like one side can have an advantage, and on the side, on the sides, the other side. I don't think it would cause that many problems.
The ones that are very close to even, like Patty and Bloody Ridge, those tend to be a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Dude.
And I mean, if you look at, for instance, Bloody Ridge, I don't know if it's the closest to a symmetrical map along with Paddy Field, if we exclude the river maps. I don't know if that has something to do with it, but the general outlining is pretty much the same.
So you guys agree, would you guys think a lot of the older maps, like AOB maps and EE maps, are a lot better designed?
EE, I think there
Well,
was a lot of great maps that were mirrored, and those were a lot of fun.
yeah, I have to agree that best maps in Wargame series have been in Escalation, in my opinion, so far.
I remember on a PLF TeamSpeak, maybe this was a couple of weeks ago, Bubba, you could correct me, we were looking at the EE maps and we're all just like relishing back in the good days of those maps.
Yeah, if they would make those maps in Red Dragon, it would be beyond awesome, but probably not gonna happen.
I think Red Dragon has the worst of the maps of any series, right?
I'd have
Yeah,
to
I
agree with
disagree
you
with
on
it.
that one.
Yeah, I have to agree as well. Escalation had the best maps, ALB, then the worst maps for Red Dragon, which is really a shame because a lot has happened since Escalation and the game has gotten a lot better otherwise, but the maps got crummier, which is a really shame.
I disagree a little. I think the European Escalation were definitely the best, but I think Red Dragon is a lot better than Airline Battle in terms of maps.
I think
Just
the.
because,
No, go ahead.
I'll finish. Just because in the Airline Battle maps were much narrower, and now they're more open, even though there are more rivers, I think.
I think that with AOB, a lot of the stock maps really kind of sucked. There weren't that many, like, when the game first came out, a lot of the maps weren't entirely good. There were some atrocious runs like Trondheim and all of that. But the DLC maps for AOB were goddamn phenomenal. Kristiansund, Gavel, Oslo was kind of fun as well, but like Kristiansund, I think was a really good map. Very nicely, it was bloody asymmetrical down the middle. Like if they could get that more some like as you guys mentioned earlier, some symmetry into these maps. Yeah, it's sort of a cheap way and a kind of a cop out for making the map balance, but by George, does it work? When trying to
Yeah,
get
but
like its
yeah,
asymmetry,
but
they don't do it all that well, Eugene, to be honest. And I think their weak point with the game series, with Wargame, has always been the maps. That's always been the weak point with me.
yeah,
yeah,
and I
especially in Airline Battle.
yeah, and I hope if they come up with some sort of like a map DLC or something that they would like preview some of the options. Doesn't have to be a ready map, just like a sketch of what they're thinking of, and let people give input on it. And now it's just been so that they make the maps, they release, they're final forever, they're locked down. And I understand that they probably have a different team doing the maps and such, but I mean, even voting on some sketches would really help out in some cases, I think.
I don't know. Do you really want people to vote?
If you have high-level players looking at the maps, they can just go and point out an obvious flaw that will not work with gameplay.
Yep. Yeah, when I say vote, I don't mean that the most voices win, but that they get to voice their opinion about the map and say, hey, this design isn't really a good one, and this one is another one that's split with the river and, you know, stuff like that.
Another question I want to ask is, do you guys think the maps change the meta a lot? Like, do you do your decks, do you play your playstyles because of the map? Like, better way to word it, is your playstyle better? Do you adjust your playstyle to the maps?
Definitely. Yes.
Decks as well.
Like playing a very wide map versus playing a tall map all bring different stuff to the match. For example, if I was playing Inchon, I might bring an SE-25. Otherwise, I'd bring a MiG instead for an ATGM plane.
And before we end this off, I just want to talk about one more thing. All the maps we discussed, every single one of them has been a land map. Do you guys like naval maps at all? Or just, I want to briefly go over naval maps. What do you guys think about naval maps? I mean, land naval and naval only. So mixed and boats only.
Mixed naval is pointless. I think that was the biggest mistake they've ever made in this game. It's
really?
Like two games taking place at the same time, and they're like not... You know, they don't intersect, right? Take, for example, like a game like Supreme Commander. I've mentioned this before. Obviously, Supreme Commander was on a different scale. And they actually tried to copy one of the Supreme Commander maps straight to the point, right? Supreme Commander had a map called Seton's Clutch, which is very similar. But look at Straight to the Point. It's just a horrible map. It's not, I mean, I don't understand what's going on that map. It's just it's just chaos.
Yeah, about the naval battle in general, it's just about massing ships. When you have enough ships, you try to go kill the other guy. Once you've killed him, he has no chance to get back in the game. Then you just drive your ships to the sector, which is spawning his ships, or then you go...
Look at a map, like Nuclear Winter is coming. Before beta, I expected to be able to field small ships on a map like that. That is the disappointment with RD.
It's a nuclear winter, it would be unbalanced, I think.
I expected something more there. Pure naval, haven't really had much fun with that. Got kind of boring after 10, 15 games. Mixed naval, I just never want to play.
I think naval is the mini game that gets boring way too quick, and no one really wants to touch it again.
What about pure naval maps?
I think most of them are, I don't know, and the naval games I've played most are either side one or the other.
Yeah.
Either they're too open and Blue Fork can just spam planes, or there's too many islands for Red Four to hide ships behind.
Yeah, I haven't really played much.
There's not really there's not much depth in the naval game. You just have to count ships. I have this many, he has that many. Then
plus,
you go. I mean,
there is one map which has not worked since the beginning of Red Dragon, and I don't think it still works. It'll cause your game to crash out of the blue. I've never been able to play that yet.
What?
Let me give that one a try right now.
Oh, since we're talking bugs, Straight to the Point has these messed up roads that take your stuff over the hill instead of going with the rogue when you fast move.
That happens to me all the time. I'm really confused because, like, why is my LAV going over the hills, like, over here and over here, instead of, like, you know, just taking the bloody road and not getting detracked?
Yeah.
I was able to get out of the blue to work without crashing just now alone.
Okay. They might have fixed it then.
I hope so. Pretty map.
Yeah, I don't want to go too much into Naval because I want to leave that to another episode. So we can all sort of like say the naval maps are just not fun and integration with the land. You guys don't like it? Because I like integration with naval land. I like being able to block off their ports, get riverboats down the center like D-Day in Paradise or another D-Day. I find it so fun being able to get some STRB-90s, get it down at canal and just blast away at any tanks. And then if they get too close, got grenade launchers and 50 cannons to deal with it.
Yeah, and
I like the mixed.
I think the mix is quite fun. It's
the
not...
scale is just strong for some maps, like Gunboat Diplomacy, for instance, if you have the naval on. It's just, there's no room to maneuver anywhere. There's basically two islands you can hide behind, and that's it.
And
it's just so small.
And you can't really do anything if the boats after you. Let's say you get the whole water side. You can only really attack two sectors, and no one goes down that river. There's not too much you can really do with the boat chair.
Yeah.
It's more of a pretty sideshow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that map is pretty sideshow.
If we get back to... straight to the point. I mean, once you get your... supremacy, you just park them over here, or then you bring them over here. And that essentially closes off an air spawn, a land spawn. It just ruins the game as a general.
Mm-hmm.
And okay. Naval battle being what it is, it's not fun to play, really.
This sort of a pretty sideshow.
One map that should be brought up is Tropic Thunder before we leave. The back zones need to be extended forward to make that map a bit more playable, if it ever does go up in player count. That map is just all about the middle. It's not the most fun in the world.
Didn't they change it after the beta?
They changed it. They removed side spawns, and that... it didn't really work out too well.
Yeah.
That map,
I remember that used to be a fun map.
Now.
Mm-hmm.
But after the change, it felt like kind of meh.
Yeah, the side spawns actually were fun on it, in my opinion.
You can't really attack
there. It would be a nice map without, one, the rivers need to go, and two, the cities need also to go. Like, replace all the city with woods.
Okay, guys, if you got any questions, I'll start shooting
playable.
Them now.
Yeah. Exactly as you said. Yeah.
No, I'll read them off to you in...
This would be a good map if the river wouldn't
once we get
be
to
there.
The end.
But even that would make it a lot better.
Yeah, I've put a lot of 2v2s on this map, and pretty much it goes... Even if you get the city, and then it's done. You can't attack back into that.
Has anyone ever had a competitive match where you could go for a back zone?
No. I played this match, in 2v2s against a lot of good players, and literally the entire map is decided within 5 minutes. After that, it's a sideshow, and you're just doing whatever the hell you want.
Random, have you ever pulled off anything where you've taken a back zone, or at least decapped it for a long period of time?
I don't know, I mean, I've played it a couple of times in 1v1, where I killed most of his CVs, and I killed his CV in this and in this zone, but you can't really capture it, I don't think, because it's just a pain. I haven't played it much in more than 2v2. Played it once in 3v3 and it was extremely boring. Now, one thing about this map though, it's a problem because you see this line I drew across the river. That's basically how it's supposed to be split, so no side is gaining points for the conquest points, but
This zone, the red side can contest, and in the beginning, in the opening rush, they can get units in here, and then there will be a fight in here, and if red wins, they have pretty much won the game. And it's a lot harder to contest this zone, I think. Might be wrong, though. I haven't played it too much.
No, in the 2v2s I've played this map maybe 30 times. The side you said, it's much more easy to contest, where the other one is really just one-sided, and it normally goes to red. I've rarely seen it go to blue without a doubling.
The one on top?
Yeah, top one. The only time I've ever seen it won by blue is if you double up there. That's the only time I've ever seen that go to blue.
Yeah, I mean, it's supposed to go to red if you look at the split in theory.
Yeah.
So, like, if the split is along this river, both sides have their four sectors, but I think the... Not really sure about this one, but you can take it with helos, and after that you have the river here, nice defensive position. Like, two bridges you have to worry about, but... Attacking a city is... you need a lot more points than are defending it, and attacking over a bridge is a massive pain. You need a lot more points to be able to cross it fast, and you need to napalm whatever from the city they're shooting at it, which is extremely hard if there are more than a couple buildings, and just not doable.
So if you guys got anything else you guys want to add to this, any other maps, anything in general you guys want to talk about?
Well, this is yet another map that suffers from river split down the middle and bridges. Same theme throughout the game.
The long story short, rivers, bridges, bad.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Mostly. Yeah.
And well, I mean, if you look at the one right below, nuclear winter is coming. It has some problems, but none are caused by the rivers, I think. I kind of like the river on this one, actually.
Yeah, because it goes down the side. So you can kind of, you can go back and forth between, like, east side here and I'm doing really bloody messily, I guess.
Yeah, this is not a bad map at all, actually.
Side spawn, save it.
Yeah.
So I think that really...
Middle can feel like a little bit of an issue, but overall, the map is playable for 3v3, even. I hope that they increase the player count for it, because I think it would add one more map to the competitive rotation.
Yeah.
Yeah,
the issue I have with it is here. You have a nice city and you have a nice forest. And it's a lot easier to get from the blue side this part. And once you have it, they only have this little thing to put a command in. And you can just bomb it or get artillery. Whereas if you have the city and the forest, you can just put the command wherever and it's going to be safe.
How would you fix that? It's possible to get into the middle from the line I just put. That does add some more options if you can deny line of sight and such. It's not that area that you mentioned getting bombed for the right side. It's not as huge of an issue as it would be on a map with less cover.
But you only have this little forest here. This one.
Yeah, that one. It's not as big of an issue, and I think you could actually place infantry like around here and not be seen. It would be nice if they had some more forest.
I mean, for the other side, it's basically free, and here you need to... I don't know, I mean, if you have infantry in here, they can just put the recon helo over here or something. Like here. I don't know, with exceptional optics, it'll probably spot it, or they can send in a suicide scout or something like that.
I found that the right side can usually occupy, like, right around here with AA, even though it's open. Depends on how much pressure is being put on the mid.
You can't do it if they have the city, right?
They shouldn't completely hold the city. The map, side spawn allows you to constantly apply pressure to the city.
But once they completely have the city, you're having huge problems in the middle. I think I played it a couple of times in 2v2 and other than that, only in 1v1.
For 2v2, I could definitely see issues, but for 3v3, never really had huge issues.
All right.
So,
by the way, what do you guys think about floods? I don't think we talked about it.
The map is fun.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely an odd map out. If you try to cross the river, though, you're going to have a bad time. Like, most of the fun is around the middle.
Yeah, what, in my opinion, what saves it is the big area where there is no river.
Yep.
The river would just continue, even as a small river, all the way up. It would be another one of those sacrificed maps, but it's somewhat playable in my opinion.
I have actually seen people go from here into here with a CV and some infantry off start. They never really hold it for much, but it just becomes a nuisance at first. The issue is if the person in the center zone can even hold it against two people then.
Is there any other last bits before we get to the questionnaire section? Or are you guys good?
Korea rocks.
Korea rocks. Korea rocks. Good or bad, what do you say?
It's a good map. It's not a bad map. It's not great. It's
mediocre.
Good. Yeah.
It's something different. Yeah. It's another wide map. Playing the far right can be insanely frustrating. The good point about river crossing here is you have the forest on each side, so you're not automatically going into depth.
Yeah, that's a lot of the maps that have these splitting rivers would get a lot better if there was forest on both sides. It would help a bit. It doesn't fix the map, but it would help a bit.
Than
just running over a bare river.
I think it would have to be more forest, like this entire part would be forest, so you can get a bridgehead and then spread out within cover like this, like we have it now. I mean, if you, let's say you go over this bridge and there are ATGMs at every point I mark, I hope you can see them.
Don't
like
see
here,
don't see
you. They can't shoot at you when you are on the bridge, but as soon as you leave the bridge, you're gonna get shot at from so many sides, and that's just not good.
Seems like every map under Incon will not like mark. You can't like mark anything. So you need to like visually, you need to verbally describe those maps.
Basically,
you can't see it?
For Korea Rocks, the left side is the fun side. The right side, you're going to end up being a bit frustrated.
Go for just an ATGM game at right side.
It's just the choke points on the right side, not even the ATGM so much, just the bridges. And the lack of cover once you get off the bridges.
Yeah.
Or playing the I can't quite see the infantry guessing game in a corner.
That's a fun game. Play Gracamo with mortars. But yeah, I think that did really cover everything, so I kind of want to get to the questionnaire section. And in the stream chat, we do have a few questions. The first one here by Dontaz Embro is, do you think mixed maps will be played competitively? Question mark. Or do you think, or better way to word it, do you guys think mixed maps, like mixed as in land and naval, do you think it could ever be played competitively?
Maybe once on Harbor for a 1v1.
Oh god, I hate that map. I hate it so much. That's my second most hated map for me.
I
don't
for a large
make
game,
it better.
No. Mixed
with,
is not very fun.
With the current chip balance and effectiveness, I don't really see that making good competitive games. It's...
Yeah, I don't think it's gonna happen.
Yeah, the thing with chips is that the more you have of them, the stronger they become exponentially. You have more close-in weapon systems. And when you have two blobs of ships shooting at each other, when one side loses one ship, it doesn't only lose firepower, it loses protection. So it starts losing ships faster. So it's not like having two tanks fire at each other and one tank die, it cascades so that the other guy loses his whole navy and the other guy loses one third of his navy. So you can, after that, you can completely rock the seas. There's no way to get back from that anymore.
Yeah, I think in competitive games, navy wouldn't be used very much with how it is, but I haven't played many competitive games with the navy and with the current balancing of sea and land sectors. They completely removed them. And I don't know, maybe on some maps, but I think mostly it would be just the riverboats with the Hellfire ATGMs.
I found that when I was playing mixed in big team games in beta, I'd either be going all in land or I'd be going all in water, and it'd switch. Like, if I was going all in water early game, late game I'd be playing all in land once I have my mass up or I've lost everything.
Yeah, in a 4v4, it, what was the map?
Straight to the point?
Yeah, straight to the point. I mean, whenever I play that, it's basically two guys on land, two guys on water. And it's goes into this cat and mouse of you watch how many ships the other guy has, and you have to get one ship now because he's got more ships than you. So it's this sort of arm race. You can force your opponent to use points on ships just by having ships of your own. Because if you lose that spawn ability or the spawn sector, then you've completely lost the seas. There's no way to get back anymore. So it's like playing poker with no blind bets, but an all-in being the minimum bet.
I think that covers that run. Another question from Michig is, first one is, how do you guys feel about the large quantity of maps that have rivers in them?
I think that's been covered. Yeah. I think they just don't add anything good to the maps, really.
Well, the main point is, rivers cutting the map in the mid, not very fun. Rivers when they're running parallel or when they're cutting off like one specific lane, those can be fun. Rivers at like the one third mark between your home and the middle, that can be okay.
I think the impact of rivers to maps is somewhere to be between slightly positive and extremely negative. And unfortunately, there are a lot more examples where it's extremely negative instead of slightly positive.
Yeah, overall it stagnates games. With if there's a river that's splitting the map, it stagnates the games, and it doesn't really make for fun games, mostly.
Agreed.
Mm-hmm. And the second part to his question, I sort of reread it here, but do you think they're pushing the amphibious gameplay a little bit too much in this game? Do you think that's really hindering the game? Hindering players' playstyle?
Overly much. Way overly much, hence why all the rivers. And, you know, it's nice to have the amphibious units in it, but it doesn't need to be the absolute staple of the game. It takes away from too much else.
Not enough brown water navy with patrol boats and stuff like that. And, having BTRs cross a river is really cool, but not when it's sacrificing the core fun tank AA infantry mix gameplay.
Yep, I have to agree with Triumph there.
Yeah, agreed.
I want to see more tank warfare in this game.
Yeah, that's... Check out the Daywalker's mod. You will find it under the tank. No, not under the tank. What am I saying? I'm under the modding part of the forum.
Yeah, I saw it.
Steel King, it's called. You should check it out. It's really nice. You will see mediums all the time. The T-72 is really nice, and the Centurions, they are completely, well, not completely useless. They have still a use, but they're not good anymore. Well, they're not great anymore. They're not the only medial you can get. But anyway, I think I'd actually like to see Phibios play more of a role, but not by having more rivers, but by having more forest around the rivers, so that you can actually cross rivers if you bomb the other side, and then you send up a couple BTR-80s or something over, which would actually be doable instead of a river and then an open field. And if you send up BTR-80 or BTR-90, probably just dies because it's immediately spotted, and then there are ATGMs and tanks. Yeah.
And another question, just real fast. What maps should they, if they were to bring back maps from the older games, what ones should they bring back?
I'd like to see Darlana, personally. I think in Red Dragon, Darlana could be awesome.
What was that? Was that ALB?
Yeah. Darlana from ALB. But remove, you know, on the flanks where they had those towns, remove the town sectors. Keep them kind of open.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe with some bushes and stuff.
I thought Bergen was a very solid map in ALB.
Definitely.
That map remixed for Red Dragon sort of style of gameplay, it'd be great. Also, I liked 3 Mile Island. It's just, I'd like to have it be one corner spawn versus another corner spawn. With the river crossing units, it could be a lot more fun. A remixed middle would be really cool.
Yeah, have to agree. And fill the gap from escalation.
I think Kristiansand would be an awesome map to bring back, because you could actually take advantage of that river going parallel in Kristiansand and use that to as a shortcut to get across back and forth. And it's
only if they had a forest along it. Wasn't that map originally from EE?
No, Kristiansand was in the, was it?
Yeah, it was it was left versus right.
Oh, yeah, I remember now, yeah.
Blitz.
And
Blitz was a 1v1 map.
Yeah.
I remember that, yeah.
And it ended in arty spawn every spam every single time. Well, almost always.
But the Christian Sun layout, it could be a lot of fun.
And just one final question. It's more of a map-specific question from Morlock. On Korea Rocks, if you guys have scrolled down to that, tell me once you're here. On the right side, if they were to extend that further so it goes a bit, add a bit more land mass to that and make it go further off the map and add like a new part of the map here, do you think that would help extending the right side of that, extending the right side of that map on Korea Rocks?
I don't think that they'll ever really extend anything more than a zone or remake conquest or control zones.
Let's say
they extended.
Let's say theoretically they extend it somehow, magically they extend it. Do you think it would help the right side?
It'd probably help the top on the right with another place to cross if they really wanted to. The thing is, if you look at the natural layout of the map, you've got that pool of water for the bottom blue side. That wouldn't really do much for the blue side there. When it comes to Korea Rocks, I think they could just remix all of the zones and create a very different, new feeling map out of that alone.
Oh, right. I actually said it wrong. I'm trying to figure this out. But, like, extending the right side to be an island fight? The whole island is a fight and not just a map extension.
What?
Yeah, I'm a bit
confused. What does he want to extend? The island, the zone, the river, and well...
Well, if you extend it anymore, it becomes like Apocalypse Imminent. Right?
Yeah.
You're talking about the Boris zone.
Oh, I mean the zone. I think increasing the zone to go across the river.
Oh.
Across the river? That would be alright.
So not just on that island. Or like making the whole island and like the whole island, a zone. So just like one small section of the island. I think that's what he was actually trying to get at.
I think that with the zone that they have there, they need to add more forest cover than they could theoretically extend the zone, and it'd end up okay.
Yeah, I think current state, extending the zone across the entire island really wouldn't fix it. It's just more of that needs a little bit more forest on it.
You would end up playing more guessing games, trying to find where the infantry command squad is. It's like right now, you can already place one down in a corner and not get recce on it, even if you suicide an exceptional in.
Play Rackamo Mortars.
Yeah, Whack-a-Mole is not my favorite game.
But see, doing it against enemy artillery. Back and forth, trying to get on Trotty.
I think they just need to release, you know, some sort of map modding tool for the game and let the community handle it from there. Because I think we know what we want, and I think we as a community can create the maps that are conducive for competitive play. I just don't think Eugen is going to be able to do it, really. Because in order to understand if a map works or not, you have to play it competitively. You have to be able to exploit every little sector and resource on that map. I just don't see it happening. I really don't.
It does suck, because a lot of these maps, they look really nice. They're very good looking, and they try to do something with them, but a lot of them just sort of suck. A lot of them suck.
Yeah, like I said before, I think most of the maps are made by an artist who makes a pretty map with rivers and mountains and trees and stuff like that, and then they put some sectors here and there and call it a map. Mostly.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
I've also heard that.
I mean, basic stuff like we talked before, the travel times to certain points. It's not too hard, but still it's left untouched.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a shame when the game is so great in other essence that the maps have to drag it down like this.
And with like a lot of games, it's any game in general, from first person shooter to RTS, what makes it really good or bad is the maps, because that's what the people are going to be playing on. That's the interactive game on the maps. And if a lot of the maps suck, and that's not really going to help, that's going to bring down every single other component of your game, like you guys just said.
Yeah. Symmetrical maps would be ideal, but I don't think that's going to happen. I still remember one of the most competitive maps in a game like Command & Conquer Generals was Tournament Desert. It was one versus one map. Fantastic, you know? Everyone enjoyed it. It was symmetrical to a very large extent. And it was fun. And I think if they implement that sort of thing in a lot of the maps here, it would be, you know, it would greatly improve gameplay.
Yeah, the thing with symmetrical maps is that it might look like a overhead view like this, but once you're actually playing the game and, you know, you're in the heat of battle, it doesn't bother you at all. I mean, it looks a bit boring when you look at it from overhead, but whilst in-game, it doesn't really
They may not look as pretty, but they're workable, these symmetrical maps.
Yeah.
And I think it about covers everything we're going to talk about, unless you guys want to add any quick final points. I'll take it as a no, and let's just end things off. So yeah, this has been quite a long run, and crap, I don't really know how to end us off. Should we all just say goodbye?
Goodbye.
Bye. Yeah.
Goodbye.
Yeah. And that is the War Room. You guys take it easy and have a good run. Ta-ta.